find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh, check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you.
Hey, did you hear about that new band? Their name is 1023 Megabytes. They haven't got a gig yet.
I'm getting awesome! You're getting awesome! We're getting awesome! Yeah, that's what I said now! I'm getting awesome! You're getting awesome! We're getting awesome! Yeah, that's what I said!
Hey guys, it's the AwesomeCast, episode 258. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron. No, not John Chichilla. What the heck?
That's not you.
That's not who I am. Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitters in Pittsburgh, PA, in the Mayhem Studios, ready to talk geeky, get techie, and have some fun here for the next hour-ish as we podcast away. With me, we got the double dose on the couch right there. We got first on your left on the video, or your left on the audio, if that's how you want to play it.
My is left. Not that left.
Yeah. It's Katie Dudas at Kate Dutters on the Twitter social media extraordinaire.
Hi, guys. How are you?
And also with us, the man of the gadgets, John Chichilla.
How's it going? Can I get that as like a subtitle?
The man of the gadgets. Hold on a second.
Oh, man. I'm John Chichilla.
You're John Chichilla.
Nice to meet you. I'm John Chichilla.
Everybody is John Chichilla.
It's going around.
I want to see Sorg like Mission Impossible style, like rip off a mask and it's me underneath.
We do not have the budget. There you go.
You've replaced us all with gadgets.
Man of the gadgets right there. But... Awesome. But you can check us out at awesomecast.net. We actually have had a lot of interviews since we've met last. We talked to Arnie Roth with the upcoming Final Fantasy Symphony that's touring around, and he's going to be conducting, I'm not going to screw that up again, with the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra here in town on August 1st. So go check that out, as well as my talk with Justin Kanacki about PodCamp Pittsburgh and everything right and wrong with social media and podcasting and freelancing today. All those at awesomecast.net. You can join us here live at live.sorgatronmedia.com or live.awesomecast.net. And we start recording and kind of setting up around 6:30 p.m. Eastern time and get started pretty promptly afterwards after you watch us eat pizza and play with the dog. So there's that. And please subscribe to us. Please comment on iTunes. And please, please check us out on Patreon, of course, patreon.com/awesomecast. Thanks to our friends at Thistlesea Business Development up in Cranberry Township here in PA for contributing to the show. Thank you very, very much for that. So let's get into our awesome things of the week. Chilla, what do you got? What do you got for me, buddy?
What do I got for you? I got the Motorola Hint. So Motorola actually had this device out on the market, and I never actually saw it. And then information leaked or was brought to light yesterday of someone seeing the Hint 2 in a Best Buy for sale. So if you look at that little device, and it looks a lot bigger on the screen than it is in real life, that is an earbud. And that earbud is the entire Bluetooth headset.
Oh, geez.
Whoa.
That's it.
Like I said, I didn't actually see many of these out in the real world before, but this is the second generation, which it seems like they quietly released. The big thing is it gets 70% more talk time. So it has 17 hours of talk time on a small earbud. What I'm interested in also, they say they improve the audio and voice control. Obviously, you're going to be controlling a lot of things with your voice since there's really not much of a button. I'm interested in the sound quality on this, especially when talking. The device does cost about $130, which is $20 less than the first version. When you think about it, think about chopping the bottom of your earbud off for like that you get with your iPhone or mm-hmm. whatever other device, and just putting that little thing in your ear, and that's pretty much what this
is.
To me, this is pretty slick and getting 17 hours of talk time. That's not standby. You're going to have to charge your phone multiple times to even talk that long. So like I said, I'm interested in testing this out. I've been testing out of a lot of different headsets recently for something we're working on at work. And 17 hours of talk time is completely amazing to me. The one thing I would like them to see them do is kind of put some kind of little USB dongle that comes with it for devices that may not make use of the best that it has to offer as far as Bluetooth is concerned. But that's kind of a TBD. But I think I'm actually going to try to get one of these to give it a whirl. I want to see what the background noise is like. Like when I have the LG Tones that AJ had, and walking down the street with those, you pick up every car that drives by.
I was going to say, so these are settled pretty much right in your ear, right?
Right.
So like, yeah, that microphone can't be good. So what's it going to pick up?
Or is it doing like, remember those, the throat ones that actually like went around your throat and kind of used vibrations in your throat to pick up your voice?
Right.
Does this pick up something through the ear canal? I don't know. But I do want to see what this is like, and how much background audio it's picking up. I'm guessing based on if you look very closely at the flat black part right there, for those of you on audio, you don't know where I'm pointing.
But then
there's that little slit.
Yeah.
Up in the center there.
Yeah.
I'm guessing between that and the bottom slit, one of those is probably noise cancellation in some way, shape, or form. So maybe they have kind of solved it. When you look at some of the, who makes the Era? Bear with me one second. Jabra. Or Jawbone. Jawbone makes the Era, which doesn't come down very far. Mm-hmm. But they have this technology called Noise Assassin, which they use for noise cancellation, that actually works extremely well. So maybe they've solved something that we don't know about. The only other thing that I do not like about this, I'm trying to standardize more of my charging and for all my devices. This has like a weird 4-pin device that it sits in. If you click on that website, click the link that says Moto Hint.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes you to a page and scroll down just a smidge. And you can see the third picture on the right on the top. It goes in this little unit for charging, which I'm not a huge fan of. That I have to carry this extra thing around to charge it. What'll be interesting is that's a power pack, so it can hold a charge on its own as well.
Okay.
And I'm wondering if that... I've seen other manufacturers do this where that takes into account for the 17 hours. So does the power pack hold 4 charges? And it's 4 hours per charge. I don't know.
This isn't something that's going to live in your ear like for 17 hours. It's going to be kind of on hand, and you pick it up when you need it, right?
Yeah, I don't know. That's where I don't know. There's not enough information yet that's broken about the device, but I'm guessing this is probably going to tie into something else, because I think Motorola has a big announcement next week.
Okay.
So stay tuned. But, oh, and it, battery life, 15 minutes of charge time. It gets 8 hours of battery life with 15 minutes of charge time? Oh, that's the Moto X. I don't know. We'll see. I'm definitely probably going to pick one of these up.
Awesome. Go check it out. It's the Moto Hint. And when's it going to be available?
It's available now.
It is available now.
Yeah, I'm wondering if Best Buy got it on the shelves early,
mm-hmm.
but well, I guess we'll find out.
All right, go check that out. Katie, you have something. It sounds like there's a story involved in this.
Oh, in real life stuff. Look at that.
Mm-hmm.
So, as some people may know, you're going to the gathering this weekend,
mm-hmm.
and you were looking for extra videos, so we're kind of turning my 5S into a GoPro. I completely wiped it. So,
and that is the one and the case that survived an Insane Clown Posse Fago Geddon concert last year.
Yes.
So we know we can do that.
We can trust it. This is my lifeproof case, which I obviously need lifeproof cases because I cannot be trusted without them.
I thought you dropped lifeproof.
I couldn't hear out of it, but I've apparently dropped the number of phone calls I made, so I can go back to the lifeproof case. And I figured out that if I press on up here where the speaker is, okay. I tend to get a little bit better.
Okay.
Because I think there's an air gap in mine.
Okay.
I don't know if you can see the little bloop, bloop, bloops. There's air underneath there, so I kind of have to press it down, and then I hear a lot better.
Okay.
But like I said, I have, I guess I've cut down the number of phone calls I make with it so I can go back to my LifeProof case. So I wanted to give you this phone, and I looked at it, and I like I said, it's gone through the gathering. It's gone through several paint, lots of painting, and it's filthy. It was absolutely filthy dirty. And I was wondering why the pictures were so bad on it, and it turns out that there's a little plastic film, which, you know, is one of the ways we knew it protected the plastic film over the camera and also over the flash. And no matter what I was doing, it was not coming clean. So actually what I figured out was lemon juice or lemon oil on a Q-tip. And you just go, pew, 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 and it took off so much dirt you wouldn't believe. Like, it was unreal. I went through 10 Q-tips of dirt. Just like,
what? That thing has been through a lot.
And then I went through and I did my own, and I was like, whoa, I was impressed with how dirty this was just from normal use. I haven't taken this guy to the gathering yet or anywhere like that or painted it. But it's amazing. I was running out of ideas. I tried using my glasses cleaner on it, and it didn't work. But the lemon juice was able to cut through the dirt and actually took paint off, which was rather impressive without doing any damage to it.
Is it safe to do on your regular, just the optical piece? Not on the LifeProof?
That's what I wonder. I would worry about doing it on the actual, because I've noticed mine, I just take my finger, because I'm like, why do these pictures look blurry? And I just take my thumb and just kind of, you know, take it. Because all I have is a bumper, and that seems to do most of the job for me. So I'm okay. But yeah, definitely, you know, considering going to the gathering stuff, you need to be a little more careful, especially on Saturday night when ICP.
Yes, so if you see a guy at the gathering with the bright pink LifeProof case, say hi to Sorg.
Hey, okay.
I should attach some lights to it, so it'd be like, blink, 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 blink. So they really could find you.
I could really have fun with that. No one is in the LifeProof, too.
I know. So it's, yeah, this is our fancy non-GoPro GoPro camera
exactly.
for the trip.
Which is exactly what I was talking about before, is I'm hoping with this next upgrade, we're going to give our 5S's to our folks and get 4S's back, and they're just going to be like what we're doing here. It just, they'll be our GoPros. They'll be our go-to cameras, that, you know, something I don't have to worry about maybe deleting Immortals for a short period of time, because it takes up a gig and a half, you know, so I can do a little more with it. So hopefully it'll be a little more unleashed when I'm filming stuff this weekend. And
you're lucky, because it's the LifeProof before they changed the bottom of them. Because this, with my new one, I can only use Apple chargers.
Right.
Because it's the Amazon and what, you know, the ones you get online for $5 don't actually fit into the charging hole. So I have to use the Apple one on here, but you can fit anything in this guy for charging.
Awesome. Awesome.
LifeProof. Love it.
So all I have is Amazons and whatever the heck we picked up at Walmart.
Yeah, mine's like Five Below, I think.
Yeah, yeah. Well, those don't last too long usually.
Yeah, that's...
It's like, well, yeah, you're going to pay for a few of them over time, but you lose one $20 cord, you kind of just suck it up, right?
Or the cat eats it.
Or really, that's an issue?
Yeah, our cat has chewed through. Like, I have to be very careful going home now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, leaving my earbuds anywhere and or the charge cords, they'll gnaw through them.
We had a roommate at a time, and it gnawed through the wire to the Wii bar, sensor bar.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so pissed. I was so mad. I was like, it wasn't our cat that did that. He doesn't do anything. He just stares at me. So
my cat will try to eat through my laptop cable. Like, if I set it, like, on the table... And it hangs down at all. He's like, what's this?
No, that's expensive.
Yeah, I was like, no, please, no.
Yeah, yeah, definitely, definitely.
What's wrong with our cats?
Awesome. So, and check out LifeProof in general. They're awesome. Obviously, they survived what they survived last year. Do we have... we should retweet the video from that,
too.
Oh, my
gosh, and what this thing went through.
Yeah,
I was soaked and covered, and I threw it on the ground because I got kicked in the face and got knocked to the ground. This is not a very
good commercial. And that's pretty much in the middle of a mosh pit, too.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, and then, like, so much Faygo, and I got pretty far, pretty close to the stage.
Yeah,
so
you
I was
did. Yes,
stretched.
You did. I had lost you for a bit, and I went in, and I'm just like, what are you doing here?
Hey, buddy, what's up?
So, awesome. I'm looking forward to doing that and see what I can get this year. So, speaking of kind of video viewfindery stuff, there's this Kickstarter that actually only has 16 hours ago. I wish I had the money to put in for this thing, but I'll look for it when it gets retail here. Looks like they're going to be delivering in November, so hopefully around then. But this is the next step of, you know, Chilla and I, we've had our experiences with Google Glass at this point, mm-hmm. right? And we see the flaws and we see the awesomeness of it, hand in hand, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna hold my comment for 1 minute.
Okay. But so this is something that was taking one of the cool parts of it as that viewfinder and having that extra screen, and that's basically it. It's called the Vufine. Like I said, it's on Kickstarter right now. It's got 16 hours ago. It's at $226,000 of its $50,000 goal. And it is a Google Glass sort of thing. It's definitely a little, I want to say, obviously bigger and clunkier. And you're going to have it tethered to something. Like this big wire is going to hang down here. But you're not going to wear this to the coffee shop, right? You're not going to be wearing this all the time. This is a specific for-use thing. So, and they're looking at some of the prototypes there that are pretty crazy. This actually reminds me of when I picked up the glass, we did a thing on Night Talk here on PCNC with some of the guys from Carnegie Mellon University in the robotics department. And they showed like a prototype of what would be what we know as these, on-face cameras from the early 90s. And bigger version, but that's what this feels like. This kind of screen that you can position in your view. And it's just kind of displays a video. Now, this takes HDMI. So their argument is Google Glass is trying to be a cell phone on your face. But most of us are happy with the functionality that we're already carrying around with our iPhones, with our Google phones and everything. So as long as your device can do an HDMI out of any sort, it will input into this device. And now you have it in front of your face. So one of the samples that they get, I'll try to throw it up here on the video, but one of the samples that they give is, if you bring up Google Maps, now it's right up there in your display. They're connecting, I think it's a little weird, but like this guy has a GoPro on his helmet, but then he has a display of what the video is that GoPro's taking, right? Or somebody with a selfie stick as he's skateboarding in that video. I see this as the perfect thing for when we're doing shooting for pro wrestling sports. You don't want your head down in that display because mm-hmm. you want to make sure something's not coming at you. Being able to look up and have that display and move your camera independently seems like a really, really cool application of this. And the thing is only $150. So in wearable wise, it's fairly affordable. And I don't know. I think it works really well. Here's the problem. You need to have glasses. I don't know if they have any kind of... they have to have some sort of kind of Google Glass style frame for those without glasses. But for most of us, this just fits, right? Because I want to say mostly in a work world, you're going to be wearing glasses anyways. And it just attaches right to that. So now, Chilla, do you have thoughts on this then?
Well, I was interested because I heard a conversation about a couple people that have Google Glass and how mm-hmm. they still use it. I am less apt to use it as a second screen. Mm-hmm. I'm using it from a photo documentary standpoint.
You're using the camera that makes everybody else concerned
right.
about the device.
Now, I usually only use it around the house.
Yeah, you're not wearing it out.
I'm not really wearing it out. It hasn't even gone past the backyard. It's actually going to go past the backyard here in the next week.
Oh, yeah?
Because it's going on vacation with me and we're going to the beach.
Nice. Don't get sand in it.
Yeah, I won't. But a lot of people I've heard recently, and I think it was on Mac Break or I'm not sure where it was, but they were talking about, or maybe it was Twit. They were talking about how, I think it was Andy Anako was saying, he'll go on a walk. And he uses it all for note-taking.
Mm-hmm.
So the second screen capability of this is nice, but I feel like you're really... That's all it is.
I don't
feel like you're getting all of the stuff that makes Google Glass special. This is just a small second monitor.
It's really just kind of paring it down, isn't it?
Which is where I think the price point comes in, right?
Right. Right.
What I'm also confused on is, so there's a battery, but if I have to be plugged in all the time, what's the battery for?
Was the battery built in, or you mean the battery is, there's like an extra battery, or?
It says internal battery.
Right.
Probably, I don't know, a few, the fourth picture segment down.
All right.
It has the virtual screen and the adjustable arm and the internal battery, that one.
Okay.
So what's the internal battery for if I have to?
Well, no, it's going to be plugged in HDMI-wise. Like, you have to always have a video feed. That's okay. What the plugin's going to be. Now, it's also going to have, if you want more power and or to charge, that the, so it basically has two ports. One's the HDMI, and you're going to need some kind of adapter cord, you know, to go from, basically they're going to have like a mini HDMI port to whatever you need, like a full-size one maybe on a camera, or whatever adapter that, you know, you plug into an Android device and it'll turn it into HDMI. So, I mean, you're going to have to figure out that part of it. And I don't know what plugs into, say, I don't know, a GoPro or something like that. But I think you're right. You're right. It doesn't replace the Google Glass, but I think it adds a new functionality. Because I mean, another big issue I have is I was just shooting outside on Saturday night at this ball field show. And when you have that LCD, you know, you also have, I can't see it in the sun. Is mm-hmm. another problem.
That's very
so
true.
So this would also help that.
I'm just thinking about, and they show the person using Google Maps mm-hmm. and setting it up while they're walking. Think about the phones that we use. Now, some of the Samsung devices have HDMI out, so you can plug direct.
Right.
The majority of them, you're going to have a clunky, chunky Lightning or USB to full-size HDMI to convert full-size HDMI to micro to mm-hmm. then plug this thing in.
Right.
I think it's going to be great when you're stationary or when you're, like, you're at your desk right now.
Right.
Or you're standing still.
Walking around doing directions probably doesn't make sense. Yeah, too much sense.
The drone thing looks really, really cool.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can be looking down at your device, controlling it, as well as seeing it while you're looking down. The GoPro thing I think is great because a lot of the GoPros don't typically have a viewfinder on them.
Right.
And the viewfinder's typically never somewhere where you're gonna actually be able to look at it
right
while you're filming. So I think it's brilliant for that. I'm just not sold on the application. Like, if you look at like the video of the drone pilot, the contraption he has and the way this is hooked up, and
yeah, he's got a pretty hefty controller slash, and I'm guessing this the display is actually probably going to his phone, and the mm-hmm. phone is actually connecting to his
scroll
headset.
Down more.
Okay,
keep scrolling, scroll down a little more okay. Oh, that one right there, rewind,
that's his video.
Yeah, rewind okay. that one to the beginning.
Okay, so he's got like a little a cell phone on an arm that's like on, you know.
But go to the first frame of that video.
First frame, okay. Oh yeah, look at that! Look at that thing. That's crazy.
It's huge.
Yeah,
I mean, it looks like he has an iPad Mini.
Yeah.
Wired into a controller, wired into like a PlayStation 2 controller, and then he has like three cords coming out of the headset. It's just a lot.
It seems bulky.
I don't think you're going to be lugging that around a lot of places.
But if you're doing this kind of like drone videography, this is a very specialized thing. So you're going to, you know, just like when you go somewhere to shoot something, you know, and you have the lights and the cameras and the teleprompter and the people with the boards shining the light. Like, I mean, this guy's doing a very specialized thing here. Mm-hmm. And I think he will go through the trouble if that means he's going to get better stuff. Right.
Yes.
Because once again, if he's using, well, I guess what he's got that map going on. How does he? I don't know. We I didn't watch the video in advance, but the video's outputting from that app. You know, again, LCDs in the sun, it's hard to tell.
Mm-hmm.
So this kind of would pick up on that issue too. So no, this is going to be very specialized.
If you're lugging this much stuff around, just bring a dome with you to shade
just
everything.
Just bring a dome.
If you look at it, I mean, it plugs into a camera. Mm-hmm. So if I'm a photographer out using my digital SLR, I can essentially take photos of things without having to be behind this camera. So you're able to place your camera in a spot that maybe you can't stand behind because you can't get back far enough.
Right, right.
Or,
but you're, but you're still tethered to it.
Yeah, but I can set it down and still have it back to the... It just gives you this additional, which I was one of the neat things when I talked about the Wi-Fi connection to my phone, was I can still take the pictures despite the fact that I'm not attached to the camera.
Right.
And sometimes with that, if you're trying to photograph kids or pets, they don't like the fact that you're like, hey guys, I got a camera in my face.
Yeah.
Or wildlife.
Yeah.
Or
oh yeah. Chasing deer down. Here, buddy. You're able to set it up, you know, maybe even next to you, and you're kind of still like, doo doo doo, or you can entertain with one hand while you take your cat photos. You got the cat toy here now, and you can still see the photos you're taking. And
mm-hmm. I've noticed, and I don't know if this, you know, you guys are more photography minded than me, but I noticed, you know, one guy I was watching taking photos at one of the many, many wrestling shows the last 2 weekends. And they would do this thing where they take the camera and just kind of do a blind take, it seems, and then set up and start doing one. And I don't know, is that like, are they just kind of trying to take a wild shot? Or is that something where if this was connected, like they would know more what's going on when that happens? Or they just got really bad technique?
It depends on what they're doing. They could be just checking to see their light balance. Like,
okay.
To see,
yeah. Exposure and light balance.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that could be one thing. I mean, they could just be... I mean, I've taken photos wildly just because maybe I'm like, oh, let's just see what happens with this angle because my arm's 8 feet long.
Right.
I might be able to get a better crowd shot. It's like having a selfie stick, you know, being tall and stuff. But...
Bring a Dutters with you. It's like having a selfie stick.
Hire me. I'll be your friend.
I was very pleased when Kevin Nash came to the ring on Saturday night. And I forgot what it's like to have a camera that actually has a viewfinder and everything at ringside and just be able to just get my arm up and like making a shot that looks like it's taller than him.
Yeah.
And he's 6 foot seven, eight, something ridiculous like that. He's a big, big dude. And I'm a lowly, lowly 6'4 in comparison.
So short.
To somebody like that, to Mr. Magic Mike himself. He had people signing. That was like the big angle of the match. I'm sorry. This is the wrong podcast. But anyways, no, check it out. It's Vufine. Like I said, it's got a few hours left. If you're hitting this up tomorrow, I'm sorry you missed it probably. But I'm sure it's going to be something that's going to be on retail here in a few months. And I know I'm earmarking it. I think I sent a reminder to look it up at the beginning of November and see if it's something I can purchase. Because I'd love to get that for my videographers ringside. Just so it's a little safer for them, mm-hmm. really. So... All right, so what is our app of the week?
I think you'll like this one.
Oh.
It's called Besomebody.
Mm-hmm.
They've already raised $2 million. What it is it's an app connecting passionaries with people wanting to learn. And they're talking about how teaching is kind of a lost art. And in the article, the one article I pulled up, it was discussing on how expensive going to college is and how much loan money people have now out. But what this does is connects people, like for example, if you know how to podcast, if you know how to use a camera, you know how to do makeup, you know, mm-hmm. for a particular genre, and connecting them and enabling them to reach people who are also interested in it. When you set this app up, you sign in and then you say what you're passionate about, and it'll connect you with people in the area who are offering classes. And so it's offering the teachers a way to make money, another way to make fun, you know, raise money for themselves, mm-hmm. and allowing people to learn specific skills that they're very interested in without having to go take classes at a university level or a community college. So I think it's really cool. I just got a chance to check it out today. And but they're also hiring... They're accepting applications now for ambassadors for local areas. This started in just Austin, Texas, but now they're kind of expanding out.
Mm-hmm.
And they haven't released Android yet, so it's just an iPhone thing now. But I think it's a really neat thing and a really unique opportunity, especially in our area with how many makers we have and you know, our tech interests and just, you know, knitting even. Something along those lines, something where you're just passionate about doing things or having an adventure. You host an adventure. Where maybe somebody wants to learn how to ride a dirt bike or how to kayak. I mean, any of these skills that you have that you know that you're interested in and you're passionate about, you're able to teach somebody and make money at it.
That's awesome. So this kind of it feels like without the you know the hangout components, but it feels like what Helpouts was doing,
mm-hmm.
where it was kind of connecting you and giving you this place to say, hey, I'm an expert in X, let me help you. That seems like what's going on here. It's really interesting.
Yeah, it's very neat. It's the app itself is very nice. It's very bright. It's easy to use, and it's just I'm really interested to check it out further.
It seems like it would be the perfect complement or supplement to bridge from PodCamp to PodCamp.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you have people that are passionate. They have the ability to teach, to keep that teaching going year round. I think this is like the perfect tool for that.
Mm-hmm. I need help setting up a Twitter account. I need help. I mean, it's right. Pretty much anything.
Mm-hmm.
Up
mm-hmm.
to actual real life adventures, you know, in the real world beyond tech. Learn how to surf.
How does it connect people? Like, is it sit you up and you do a meeting, or is
yeah,
it
you,
like
you
a
connect
video?
Online first and okay. then you meet in person.
Okay.
So it's a lot of there's some verification involved. So you're not just like showing up and it's somebody going hey and they're crazy.
Awesome.
Not too terrible. Not you know crazy in the scary regards. Not like crazy like we are, which we're safe. We're just fun. So I mean it's a nice way to. I mean it could be a nice way to supplement your income while mm-hmm. doing something you really enjoy.
Awesome. I actually got it loaded up here, so mm-hmm. I'm gonna poke around at this a little bit. Where is that? There it is, with everything else going on. And there's our chat room, too. Oh, look, they have cat hands.
Pause.
There's cat hands showing you how this works. You find people around. All right, you book your experiences from local experts called passionaries. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's interesting. That's fun. And then you get on a dirt bike, and what the heck?
We're riding a dirt bike.
They're really loving this dirt bike kind of mechanism here, aren't they?
My gosh. And if you look at the passion things,
my stuff.
There's anything from bulldogs to, I think it was decorating apartments, small apartments, like anything you could ever imagine having a passion about there. It's pretty much on that list.
That's so, awesome. Yeah, I think I'm going to look into this a bit.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
because I mean, even with coding, I mean, how many people we know could have you know, do this or even wanting to attend it since
oh,
I can't, I don't have the kids software that they all have now.
We have action sports, we have acting, we have somebody periscoping me, acro yoga. What the heck? So they picked some very interesting things to start off with. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm just in the A's, alpine climbing, alternative music, America. What do we have in America? Let's see, hashtags be somebody, 30 seconds to Mars, 3D modeling. Okay. Let's see what we got. Everybody's texting me.
I know.
Stop texting me. So wait, oh, I'm supposed to select my passions. Oh, okay. I am not a 3D modeler. We're going to back up on that. We'll finish that later, but you get the idea. That looks like a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely going to look
into
that.
They said that some of the passionaries have made $3,000 in a month.
I'm in.
It's like sold. Everybody's in.
I'm in. And everybody's going to, until everybody floods into this thing, and then
so we're first. Pittsburgh,
first.
We're first.
There you go.
Not seen anybody else
there
talk
you go.
About
I'm
going to
finish signing up for that in between
you.
Shows here. But in the meantime, hey, check out our friends. We're also passionate about pizza around here, aren't
is
we?
Is that an option?
Is that? Ooh. Oh, wait. Let me look it up. Let's see. Pizza,
passion option.
Pizza. No results.
Ah.
You can start it.
Whoa.
We're making this happen. We're bringing pizza to be somebody, and we're hoping to help Slice on Broadway bring pizza to you. If you're in the South Hills of Pittsburgh here, go check them out. They help us out. They support it so these fine people can sit through their dinner hour here on the couch and not be hungry.
It is tasty and delicious.
Yes.
I recommend ordering not just one pie, minimum three. You gotta
minimum
order
three.
If you're gonna order one, you gotta order three.
Yeah, because you want lunch the next day.
You gotta taste all the
snacks.
Different gourmet ones. Oh, it's delicious.
Mm-hmm. Go check them out. Hey, the Dutters, we just went to Slice Thursday night on a whim.
Yeah, we went out there and enjoyed all the delicious pizza, and we love the guys there are so awesome. The guys and the ladies there are just so
they are.
Such, and they anything to take care of you, anything you need. They're like, do you need this? That's just awesome.
There's Rico on the front page right there. Go check them out and tell them you heard about them on the AwesomeCast, sliceonbroadway.com. They're in Carnegie in the South Hills along the tracks and Beachview, as well as the Main Street. Wait, I just mixed things up, didn't I? In the Main Street of Carnegie on Main Street. Yeah, okay. They're all the places. SliceOnBroadway.com to find out those actual places, because I'm mixing them up. PJH_Slice on the Twitters, and SliceOnBroadway on your Instagrams and Facebooks. Thank you so much for supporting the show. Now let's go check out what happened last week at Sorgatron Media.
I was going to say, I want to ask Chris if you're just like breaking out and Chachi plays plugs like in the middle of the night, you know?
Sleep Chachin.
And she just like reaches over like, I know, I'll donate in the morning.
You know, typically speaking, by the way, that was like my biggest fear was like, if a microphone even got within, like, 100 yards of me, I was like, oh my God, I'm going to die. I'm going to combust right now. Like, this is the end of my life.
I don't know if indie wrestling shows had wealthy patrons who earn their money selling LSD all up and down the West Coast.
I don't know about in Pittsburgh, but I'm sure somewhere there is.
That was the case for the Grateful Dead.
I like the Hype Bros. Like, I like the movie Batman and Robin. Are they a good tag team? No. No. But are they entertaining and campy?
Yes. No.
Absolutely. Yeah, Mojo Rawley is essentially NXT's bat nipples.
Chachi Plays for Kids is coming back again, the 24-hour game-a-thon for youth arts programs in Pittsburgh. August 7th and 8th at the Toonzeum, or join us live at ChachiPlays.com. Find out how you can make a difference to and donate today. ChachiPlays.com.
Up, down, down, left, right, BA, BA, start!
All right, please check out everything at SorgatronMedia.com. Some great stuff going up, a lot of different podcasts. We'll always have something going on. I hope we're filling your e-holes. Your e-holes? That's your ear-holes. It's going to be a long night. It's going to be a long night. So let's get into some stories. Dutters, you have a lot of stuff in here.
Hey, you know what? You there's specific notes. If you ever see our notes, it specifically says overloaded in case we have... in case we need them. So guess what? I was overloading.
Good job. Good job. Go ahead and pick one. What do you want to talk out of this menagerie you have going on here?
Oh, my gosh. Okay. My two favorites. the first one is this Make University. Since we kind of already talked about, it goes along the lines with the Besomebody, where instead of traditional universities, again, with the whole student loans and just debt just being completely out of control, they're offering more... too specific. It's just like the techs, the schools you had with the, well, they still have like School of Trades. Instead of that, it's got a more tech angle on it. So there's like these make universities where you actually learn to code or you engineering and just very specific things, not that you have to sign in for a 4-year degree to get. So you can still get these skills without having to go into a traditional university or college experience. So this is kind of one of those questions where are we going to start seeing a shift from traditional universities to product universities, which just specifically focus on a trade or a product?
I like that.
Don't we kind of have those, though, with tech schools and trade schools? And I mean, I've seen shifts in Cisco engineers and things like that where they're becoming more specialized and it's more of like a product. Single product, single specialist category. Is this just another way of doing that?
Or? It seems like it's expanding beyond what we've seen traditionally. It's more of, you know, computer based, the software based, the firm, you know, those kind of along those lines. And the only issue, the only way that this is going to ever really fly is if we can get companies to drop the "Do you have a degree?" question on their when you apply.
It should be more, do you know how to make this thing?
Yes. And it's going to hit a point where it's like, it's no longer, do you have a degree, which, oh, automatically qualifies me for everything. It's going to be like, do you have the skills, which, oh, wait, now you're specifically getting to what I want.
And I know, we've seen that a lot over the, my wife always says, you know, all these people have paralegal degrees, but she's the one that knows how to paralegal. You know, and I don't know how many people I saw graduating from the Art Institute, like my colleagues, you know, and then saying, their stuff didn't look that good yet they graduated, right? Yeah. What are they going to really do with that? They went through the motions. I remember having an SQL class, and because of whatever was going on with the server or something, we never actually got anything to work the entire class. Yet. We all kind of pass because you copied the code from here and it should have worked, but something else is going on. So we never actually made something function, right? We're not making products from class to class. We're just saying, do a thing in Flash that nobody's ever going to use in the real world. And it just didn't work. And you get stuck in these places. And that's, I mean, I think especially when you look at, you know, art institutes and such like that, you know, great, you know how to take pictures. How do I make money at this, you know, is not added into that, right? And that's why we have like a hundreds of photography students in Pittsburgh, and then AIP getting in trouble for that. So, I mean, I see this. I can't, like, this has been a longstanding discussion, but I can... Do we have him on this show? I was Steve Klabnik that had left school, did coding, and he's doing all kinds of crazy stuff now. Like, that seems to be the way to go. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't matter what degree as long as you have knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, I think experience is part of that too. So I hope a lot of this also lines you up with. It'd be interesting if stuff like this, they actually took companies and got them to give like a real world problem. Cause like what you were talking about, Sorg,
right.
You know, you taught them, you learned something in Flash that you're never, ever going to use.
Right.
So how do you get real life use cases and company problems to solve?
Right.
And then adapt them into the curriculum. And again, I feel like it would also help keep all of the learning current. Because you see a lot of areas where the stuff is ASP version 3 or 4, and it's like, okay, that's 12 years old.
Right.
The theory is still the same, but none of the code's used today.
Right, and I even felt like the most I got out of was when I took what I learned in class and actually made a project. You mm-hmm. know, that's why I started WesternPAJuggalos.com. That's where I took this, and this was the place to play with this. I for whatever reasons I never got an internship, and to get into the business world and figure that part out. And I think that's also on. Unfortunately, it's also on the student themselves to have the motivation.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to know that I need to not just go to my classes and report in and do what I'm told. I need to do something with this mm-hmm. because you're just not going to rise above that at mm-hmm. that point. And you have to have a certain kind of motivation that some people don't get until they've been in the workforce and realize how much it's not working after a couple years for them. Before they say, oh, no, I need to do this thing. Like, something has to switch in your brain mm-hmm. or already be there for you to get in that maker mode. And actually, if you're a maker, you know, you're already in that mode probably. And you're already finding the stuff on the internet and going and probably going to these universities and saying, nobody has anything for me, mm-hmm. too. So there's a lot of problems are going to be solved. And for what should be the most intriguing thing, of this country, if I can get patriotic, becoming a place where we make things again. So,
it'd almost be nice, just like Chilla was saying, to have an agency that kind of acts as the middle person to connect companies. Because I know with Point Park, they have Wood Street Communications, where you partner with nonprofits. So you're doing social media with a nonprofit. You're doing
this perfect.
But then you still have to go through the university. Right. So if you kind of had a company that was more, hey, you know what, we have people who want real world experience that they can put on their resume for doing social media, give us a sign up for this and we'll help you out.
Mm-hmm.
Which is not something I think we've really seen beyond a university level, at least in Pittsburgh. So here we go, guys.
Let's start it.
We can do it. And then so we could have, you know, people apply to either work there or people apply to have our services.
Awesome.
They get real world experience, and businesses get stuff for free or free-ish, depending on depending on how we're gonna make money off this.
It's the new phase of use an intern. Yes. You know how many times I've said I needed to get this to happen. So well, get an intern. I'm like, can I? But anyways, all right, so I have this article I put in here. There's a lot of stuff in here that I don't understand, but the general gist of it I do get. It was really kind of, it's from Ars Technica, and the title of it is Your Body, the Battery, Powering Gadgets from Human Biofuel, and it kind of goes into how we could be doing this. This goes back to, for me, Chachi saying how he wants a screen implanted in his arm, and you got to think, you're making a lot of energy, that's how we run, and how could we harness that it's just, that's what powers my smartwatch, you know? Not that I need much for the Pebble, but still, that's at 10%, so I could use it right now. I don't know. It's interesting, and I wonder how far off we are from this happening. Chilla, have you been following anything like this?
I have not been following anything to the point where it's tapping in, like this actually goes into like bloodstream, and mm-hmm. I've heard of like trying to tap into glucose.
There's a lot of prophesizing about technologies. There's a lot of Star Trekery, I think, happening in this article. But still, it's fairly grounded in science. But what
I have seen is more of like the kinetic energy and the movement type and harnessing movement.
Right, right.
I was actually, there's a CBS or not PBS Kids app, and it actually has all of the stuff on PBS, and you can watch like the latest episode. And one of them was this guy that took their infant's jumper, like the thing that you mount in your doorway.
Yeah.
That's like on a big spring, and yeah. You put your kid in there, and it's a way to definitely neglect them but keep them busy. So they sit there and bounce, right? And it keeps them occupied and it keeps you both sane. What he did was, though, he, on some kind of metal rod with magnets around it, he mounted magnets, and the magnets would actually then cause a charge to build. And then he actually harnessed that charge to, like, I think, recharge batteries or something like that.
Nice.
So I think if you did the same type of thing, and I've heard of people, like, on their bikes, you can get the thing that will actually power, like, the light on the back of your bike.
Yeah.
I've seen people do that, but to, like, charge their phone or to charge other things that they can then plug in while they're riding. I think my mom was looking at one for her that would charge her phone. Because when you think about it, you're using GPS, you're using some kind of Bluetooth thing to calorie count, you're using something to monitor your heart, all that kind of stuff. Obviously, that's definitely chewing through the battery on your phone. So if you can harness the fact that your wheel is spinning around and round and round, it's kind of the same concept of, I think, the Prius does it. When you brake, it reuses some of that heat and energy and uses it to partially recharge the battery.
Right.
Think if you could do something like in your shoes, right? When you step, obviously the rubber in the sole of your shoe compresses.
Somebody is doing that, actually. Soul Power here in Pittsburgh is doing that.
Okay.
To help power, help bring power to, I think, lesser countries, that need it. They don't have electricity. So that's completely happening.
So I've heard more about the kinetic information than I have, like, let's tap into the glucose in your bloodstream or things of that nature.
Right, right. Yeah, it gets weird because they do get into like the Google contact lens, which is what we know that they want Google Glass to become. And that makes sense. And I think a lot of people would want something like that too. So, it's interesting. There's a little bit of just pontificating here about the future here. But I thought it was a really, really interesting concept.
And like the kind of the creep factor in this kind of worries me when you start talking about tapping into past the kinetic concept. Like, what happens if your watch sucks all the iron out of your body while you're sleeping never wake up? Like,
oops.
Skynet decides to just take out everybody, and then we're all like living in the Matrix where it's just barely keeping us alive, and we're using to be power the machine. I don't know. It seems scary.
Well, anyways. Yeah, I'm sure there's a movie. There's a scary movie coming out of this somewhere along the line, right? So,
I mean, would you want to power your devices with something that's going on inside your body versus just the kinetic motion?
You gotta think about it. So it, the way your body works, if I'm understanding this correctly, so we all try to run and do this other stuff, get some exercise in order to burn our calories, right? So what? And that extra power just stores as fat. So what if that extra power, we're burning those calories by supplying energy to our phone, you know? And then that's, now we're kind of generating, I mean, there has to be a balance. That's the problem.
There needs to be a balance.
And people are really bad about the balance about food and energy and everything to begin with. So it can get complicated, I think, for the normal person too. So I don't know. All right. I think we go back to Katie on this one. There's a Chilla one. I'm sorry. There's a Chilla one. Google Plus Chilla photos are going away.
Yep.
What? No.
So because Google released photos, They're getting rid of the photos section in Google Plus.
All that means is the button's going away, right?
From my understanding, correct.
Like, that's it. That's completely it.
It'll be interesting to see if there's, like, anything that we don't necessarily know about.
Mm-hmm.
Like, how are you going to... So the button's going away. How are you going to post... Like, is Google Plus, when you go to post a photo, just going to look at photos instead of Google Plus photos? Like, how's it all going to intertwine? Are they going to update the UI?
As it is, when you go to the thing, so I'm in, oh, this is the wrong one. Hold on. It's this one here. There we go. So here's my Google Photos. It's already got a photo up I took of you guys,
mm-hmm.
and some other stuff. There's nothing too dangerous in there. So let's say I want this. So you're talking about, like, the sharing within Google Plus?
But right. So are they going to, but I find it, it's going to be really cumbersome
to go
if I have to
this.
Come into Photos to then share a photo.
Right.
Plus.
Right. But it's kind of that kind of division that's happening with Facebook, isn't it?
As far as...
I mean, okay, is it easier... Are you talking about on phone, or are you talking about in browser?
Phone.
In phone? So isn't it easier to pull up your Photos app, which I would imagine you kept right next to your Google Plus app, I would think, or you just pull down your search and you popped into it. Isn't it easier to just go to your Photos app and share something out than to go into Google Plus? Okay, where'd they put that menu? It's over here. Go into the Photos, and you have to drill down into it.
Can you respond to a comment with a photo?
Typically, no. Okay. I don't think so.
Because I've seen a lot of more people doing that in Facebook, and that's where I think that workflow doesn't work out right in Plus.
No, it doesn't.
I see a lot more and more I see people responding to a picture or a comment with a photo.
Mm-hmm.
And that, how are they going to then make that work? I think they need to leave all of the photo type data in there, but instead of pointing to your Google Drive and a couple other things, they just need it to point to Photos.
Right.
They don't want to abandon the people that already use it. Like, I guess I'm having a hard time grasping what this actually means.
It means we won't cry when they shut down Google Plus eventually. or alter it, or whatever the case may be. You know, I gotta say, though, Google Plus is powerful. I mean, it really is. It gives kind of that... That side that makes you understand exactly how you're putting information in for your business. I noticed they added collections to the business pages as I was tinkering around for a client the other day, which immediately I started emulating what I do on Pinterest, because I started doing some categories on Pinterest, like, hey, here's the nutritional stuff, here's our video stuff we're doing, and kind of breaking that down a little bit. So I don't know where that shows up. I don't know if that shows up in our card in the Google search. But I'm also was very intrigued. I know how many people called our business via a Google link.
That's interesting.
So I was just looking, you get your graphs, and this wasn't there before. It wasn't there before. This is new in the last month, maybe. And, you know, you get your stats. If you have a business page or a podcast page or whatever it is, on Google Plus, you'll get a page, and if it's linked to your YouTube, you'll get your YouTube stats, you'll get your insights, and that's giving your visits and impressions. But I think that also includes, like, did they find you on Google? Did they search for this, find it? There's information, and you get that little info card on the right and everything. And that's all the information you put in there from Google Plus. But then there you go down, and there's another graph, and you know, you go, I search for Slice on Broadway on here, and I click that button to call on my phone, and it transitions over to a real call. That's a tick, and now you know exactly how effective that is. And I was looking, it was like, I don't know, something like 50 calls in the last, like, month off of there, and I was like, that's pretty good. So
I don't, and it's interesting, too, because it's an interesting metric, because I find more and more I'm less likely to add you to my phone book if I know I can just search for your information and then click to dial.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that I see myself using more and more, especially when ordering pizza from Slice, is using my iPad and dialing through the phone. So the iPad's the phone, because it's hooked up.
Right.
And I'm just tapping on the iPad the phone number, and the phone call comes up on the iPad, even though it's dialing out through the phone.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where I could see that. I'm guessing you should see that metric go up and up and up as less people store contacts and know that they can just search information and then click to dial.
Exactly. Now I can't find it. Now it's not coming up for me. Maybe it's under Insights. Now I'm concerned. Oh no, it is under insight. So it is. I never drilled that deep into this part of it. But as you get in here, this is my one client I work with, and you see their visibility and views all time, you know, all that kind of stuff, clicks through and everything. But here, right here, phone calls, boom. And it's telling you what day are the most, and you can, you know, this is the last 4 weeks, and you can go, you know, back last 12 weeks and everything like that. So very, very interesting. That's a new metric for you guys to play with your clients out there. So
I think the only reason, I'm thinking with Google Photos, the only thing that would really affect is maybe Hangouts, because there are photos that I share, that I've shared privately, essentially, between other people that I might be chatting with, you know, on Hangouts versus that I don't, you know, that aren't anywhere else. Like, they don't show up on my phone. Like, I could send, I could take a picture specifically in Hangouts and send it to somebody, and it's shared privately with that person, but it never gets into my photos.
Right, right.
So, because I've gone to look up things later, and I'm like, oh, wait a minute, that's in my Google Plus photo album because I shared it on Hangouts versus sharing it over.
Huh. Versus, like, when you do use messages on your iPhone, those photos don't necessarily go into your camera roll unless you tell it to.
Yeah, same thing. So, save it, so same thing.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Interesting. There's another with Dutters, you have a story here about Google Drive as well.
Yeah, Google Drive is kind of acknowledged that Office is still kind of number one, and you know, we still need Microsoft Office. So they're going to they're launching an Office plugin, so you're going to be able to connect between your Drive and your Office Excel and your Microsoft Word, and not just kind of in a I don't want to say a bastardized way, but that's kind of how it's been.
Mm-hmm.
Between the two of them, but it seems like they're going to start playing nice.
Well, that's nice, because I mean, maybe your workplace is using Google Drive, but you are an Office, a Word person, you know. So that's good. I think it's interesting that everybody's getting this interoperable. I mean, they're already been they had a Dropbox connection already. Mm-hmm. So
I think they recently partnered with Box too.
Yeah,
Box.net.
Yeah, I think so. Mm-hmm. I think so.
And I think that just goes to show, it shouldn't matter where I store my data.
Mm-hmm.
If you want me to edit my data using your product, then you better give me a way to get to it. And
it's also acknowledging not everything is sitting on my hard drive anymore.
Right.
So, and kind of like the, like okay, we need to address, they're going to have things in this cloud drive. It's not about that. Although it is really nice. I loaded up some OneDrive on my laptop because I'm kind of splitting things up. And I was like, I have just a couple of these videos that I've been watching. Let me just throw them into OneDrive and just kind of get used to that experience. Because I'm getting more and more people to send me files on OneDrive. And I keep getting lost a little bit with the interface. So I just want to get more familiarized with it.
So, useful tip, if you end up using OneDrive and you want more space, mm-hmm. and you go and use Bing a couple times a day, you can quickly earn credits.
Okay.
That then you can redeem for more space.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I keep getting that statement, but I never use Bing. So, you know, I always get an Xbox. I get Xbox point statements, but apparently I play too old of games for them to give me points. It's always the problem. So, hey, I just beat BioShock Infinite. I'm like 2 years late, but that's okay. I didn't pay anything for it, so.
Well, have you played any of the games that were like, if you need to get credits instead of doing like in-game purchases, you can actually go watch this video or go watch this ad, and you pick up a couple gems or you pick up whatever.
You don't know Jack is like that on the phone, and you know, I usually don't stick with those very long because it just gets too annoying.
Because the Star Wars game, Star Wars Commander, was like that, and there was something else I was playing that I stuck with to the point where I was leveled up to the point where there was no more levels for me to play until they came out with an update, and that's where it kind of lost me, was I stopped playing because I kind of hit that plateau. But I think where you, like with Bing, you can do that kind of stuff where they have like a daily thing you can go do, and if you go do it, you get points, and mm-hmm. if you get points, and you can cash it in for $10 Amazon gift cards. I mean, it's actually, I don't know how Microsoft's making money on it, but mm-hmm. it's definitely worth a few minutes of your day to start just stockpiling either disk space or money.
It's a weird social engineering experiment at the end, right?
Mm-hmm.
Dutters, what is the social media rundown for this week?
Sweet. Ready for this?
I'm ready.
Let's do it. Eli Roth producing a murder mystery on Snapchat Sunday with Crypt TV. Didn't know Crypt TV was a station, but now I know. Essentially, there's going to be some high-level Twitter, YouTube, Vine folks with a high follower count that will be killed off, and you have to figure out who did it.
Ooh.
Using Snapchats. So you're going to follow Crypt TV. Something else you may have noticed, Twitter removed the background images and changed them to a bright white bar if you're using the desktop.
I got a very angry message about this today from a colleague. I was like, they took it away. And I'm like, you spent a lot of time on your background, didn't you? I haven't updated mine for years. So that okay.
Yeah. It does give it a cleaner look, though.
Mm-hmm.
It looks nicer.
I forgot that we had backgrounds as a choice. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about backgrounds. Like, the cover photo is still there.
Yeah.
Yes.
So we're talking, and I haven't even considered the background. I think the Mayhem show had one.
And I think they left it in certain sections, didn't they?
Did they?
Yeah.
Okay.
There's the whole terms and things you can look into, certain sign-ins and public and good stuff. A drug company, Allergan, launches Actually She Can ad campaign to target lady millennials with specific health questions. So now this is it. Get on the boat. Target ladies, especially millennials. We have questions. They have answers. So it's definitely all in for the girl power, which is really awesome. And I don't know how we missed this. Wendy's is utilizing YouTube with Baconator YouTube videos. There were bacon puppets. How the heck do we miss bacon puppets? That first link is the bacon puppets there.
Okay.
It's kind of like an after school special where you don't need smoke. Look at that. But we have bacon. Yeah, so I don't know how we managed to miss this. And kind of just, I'm going to touch on this.
This gets weird.
Yeah, oh, it's the whole, all of them are weird. But they have them, it's amazing. It's a million plus, 500,000 plus watched video. It's fantastic. And somebody else I put in the show notes earlier, Target, is also going to be using YouTube, big YouTube folks, for their back-to-school campaigns.
Oh.
So all this is telling us is, you know, everybody's jump on this Snapchat. We want to reach out to the millennials. We want to jump on this new app. The millennials and the kids are on YouTube.
That's right.
When it's, go to YouTube.
Isn't Google? I think Google announced recently they're going to actually come out with a pay service for YouTube where it's going to, and they're not getting any Marvel exclusive TV show type deal there. It's going to be all YouTube generated content.
Isn't it basically, this is the one where like everybody had to re-accept a user agreement that basically says if you have ads, you can, like this would replace your ad revenue.
I guess.
Is people paying for this. And that's been a little bit of a, do I really want to do that if that's my income, you know, kind of thing. For mm-hmm. the millions and millions of YouTube, you know, view people out there. Not us. We're not getting anything off of YouTube. There's big people not making anything off of YouTube. Like, Twit does not make anything off of YouTube, for instance. It's really interesting. You have to, like, be PewDiePie in order to do this at this point. And I think it's really, really hard to get at that point. If you're like, I want to make a YouTube and get rich.
Nope.
Probably not. Your chances are not good at that rate. So, I don't know.
They got Fox to sign on. That was the new one.
Interesting.
Yeah,
interesting.
They're onto the YouTube pay service.
So, but is this like, is it a Hulu replacement? No, because it's...
No, because it's not supposed to be, it's not going to be externally generated sourced content from what they were saying. It's all going to be YouTube. It seems like it's an extension of what they were trying to do with Nerdist and when they set up all those studios.
Yeah.
And those people.
Yeah. Well, the studios are still there and they're still opening new ones.
Yeah. So that's where I'm thinking they're trying to go with
that. Where's that Pittsburgh studio, guys? Where's YouTube Pittsburgh? I mean, I think we'd have a lot of fun with
that. It's in Sorgatron Media basement.
Yeah, this is YouTube money right here. Yeah, exactly. That's why we got a Froyo machine over there. And did you notice the ball pit over by the water heater?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Okay, on that note.
We know how to party.
We do know how to party around here. But anyways, yeah, please, hey, check out everything else going on around the network. Like I mentioned, the awesome chats that we've been having with Justin Kanacki and the fellows with the Final Fantasy Symphony coming up here. And so many other great, great shows. The Power Hour I'm doing with Will. And just a bunch of basic Sorgonomics. Sign up for the newsletter. I have a lot of creative things going on. And we do that more or less weekly, except when I'm going on vacation. And we have some fun with that. Anything else going on? Anything else upcoming that you guys have your eyes on?
Windows 10
Windows 10 will release next Wednesday?
that right next Wednesday or Tuesday?
Wednesday the 29th, right? I hope Wednesday is the 29th because my deadline for something is that.
Wednesday is the 29th.
Okay.
Windows 10. I thought it was Monday. Release date. Oh, it is the 29th. You're right.
Okay. And that's going to be rolling out. You might not get it on the 29th.
You might not. It seems like it's going to be a staggered rollout. People in the Insider program are definitely going to be first in line. Also, if you got in line via your little toolbar updates, I'm guessing it's going to roll out over the next month. I'm on the Insider. I'm interested because I'm on the Insider program on one device and not on two other devices. So
mm-hmm.
interesting to see how that rolls out. Motorola is going to announce something, I think, also next Tuesday. I think it's potentially going to be two more X's, the Moto X line, and maybe another G phone. Who knows? But they have a big announcement coming up next week. And, oh, Black Friday in July.
Best Buy, right?
Best Buy is coming up to combat the crap that was Amazon Prime Day, in my mind.
Yeah. Did not feel good about that, did you?
It was horrible.
It was awful.
And I'll tell you what would have made it better, the UI.
Mm-hmm.
It's one thing to peruse a circular that says here's what we're going to be selling on Friday
mm-hmm.
versus I gotta keep clicking and clicking.
It's like punch the monkey.
Yeah, it's ridiculous is what it is. To the point where there were certain things that I actually like, the diaper genie refills that I actually wanted that sold out in like less than 30 seconds. And the kicker was, and maybe I should have spent more time on figuring out how to get back to that item, but I saw that it was coming up at like the noon hour or whatever, so I actually set an alarm on my phone at noon, and then I had to click next. By the time I got back to that section of the panel, it was sold out. I'm like, this is ridiculous.
Probably had like three.
Then don't put it on sale. And I could not find the one TV. They claimed there was going to be three different TVs on sale. I found the $4,000 Samsung one that sold out,
mm-hmm.
but I could not find the other. There was going to be a 32-inch and a something.
Right, there's supposed to be like a $75 32-inch, which would be amazing. But they had like three of them, and I guess they probably did it at like 2 in the morning, to be honest.
Yeah.
But they started at like 3 a.m. our time, mm-hmm. so. Yeah. Well, Prime Day, we've learned our lesson there. At K Dutters on the Twitters.
I'm wearing my ice cream shirt today.
Wearing your ice cream.
My Aunt Nee's
plugging in our fine establishment locally at the Aunt Nee's that we also end up. Where's that sponsor? Where's our
Aunt Nee's? We want ice cream.
Ice cream. There you go. There you go. We'll talk about you. There you go. That's a freebie right there. John Chichilla at Chilla. He's the man of the gadgets.
I'm just gonna next week. I'm just gonna have this huge thing of gadgets all around me.
There you go.
I won't be here next week.
You won't be here next week.
I'll just be lying on the couch.
In three weeks.
Yeah, no chill.
I'm not bringing all those here, but I'll do something at home. We'll figure something out.
Wall of gadgets.
Be like a green screen of just your gadgets around her.
There you go. And of course, check out everything awesomecast.net. Find out how you can subscribe to the show video and audio versions. And please comment and share and support us on the Patreon if you want to do it that way. We talked about some stuff on the show. You can also get stuff that we talked about through Amazon, help out the show, get a little bit of kickback that way, and please do that. Thank you for everybody joining us. Thank you, Missy Sorg, for doing the show notes this week.
Whoa, we got a shout out to Missy Sorg.
Oh yeah, she's been helping us out the last couple of weeks. If you have Tuesdays free, we could use a show note person for one or all of the shows. So if you do listen as usual and would like to help us out and help us out, I don't have to remember what the heck we talked about later at night when I'm doing these show edits and posts and such, please let me know. Just hit up Mike at SorgatronMedia.com or the contact form over there at SorgatronMedia.com and let us know that you can help us out. We'd really appreciate it. So with that, thank you to our awesome chat room. You've been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.